It's okay to get help from somebody else when you can no longer help yourself.
Thank you for clicking on this video. I'm Brooke Makenna, but today we are going to be talking about a boy named Stephen Stayner. Now, he went through so much in his lifetime, but even when he thought he couldn't save himself, he risked everything to save somebody else. So as much as this story and his abduction is heavy, it deserves to be told. I do want to give a warning right now that this case does involve some sexual assault as well as some attempts at suicide. And so if that's not something you could handle, I wanted to let you know so you can leave now. I never go into graphic detail about anything in case you are a little sensitive to that, but I wanted to put it out there now. By the way, I am doing Suspect Summer with cases and creepy things like this all summer long, so if you like it, please make sure you're subscribed with your post notifications on and liking these videos just to show me some support because it makes me so happy. But let's get back to the story. So Stephen Gregory Stayner was born on April 18th of 1965, and he was the third of five children. So he was the middle child. So Stephen had three sisters and one brother, and they lived in, a pretty middle-class family, I would say, in Merced, California. But when Stephen was seven, his life changed forever. So it was December 4th of 1972, it was a Monday, and Stephen was walking home from school when a man approached him that had religious pamphlets and was asking for charity donations. Stephen never made it home that day, and his family instantly filed a missing persons report. But unfortunately, no one had seen a thing. They didn't see anyone go up to Stephen. They didn't see a car. They couldn't identify anything. He just vanished. Stephen went to Charles H. Wright School, and he took the same path home every day. A classmate that day said that it looked like he was headed toward his home of 1655 Betty Street. He took the same path down Yosemite Parkway near Shirley Street, and attendants at a local service station always saw him walk by, and they confirmed that he did walk by on this day. At first, his mother didn't worry too much because he was starting to come home a little bit later after he would play with his friends, and so she really didn't think much about him being a little late. But as it neared 5 o'clock, she got a little more worried and she decided to start calling his friends. When all of his friends said that they hadn't been with him, that they hadn't heard from him, she called to file him as a missing person at 5:15 that night. Now this innocent little seven-year-old boy, who was only 4'10" and 60 pounds, was now missing. He had brown hair, brown eyes, he was last seen in a light tan-colored jacket and blue jeans, and now nobody knew where he was. All the members of law enforcement came and went to their house, and they canvassed the area of their house, around their house, on his walk home, and they found nothing. They didn't find any foul play either, so they weren't even sure if anyone was involved in his disappearance yet. They said that there was not much else they could do except for wait until the next day to see if he had returned, and if he hadn't, then they would do an insane search on foot with all of the policemen that they could gather. But until then, nothing. He wasn't found by that afternoon, and they did the search like they said they were going to, and he still wasn't found after they canvassed the entire area. And months went by and still nothing. And so his parents, as like a last ditch effort, wrote into news stations, CBS, NBC, just asking if they would talk about his disappearance and put his picture out there. And they both responded saying that it had been too long since he disappeared, so it was no longer relevant enough to put on TV. 7 years went by with no sign of Stephen, and on February 13th of 1980, another boy went missing 5 hours away in Ukiah, California. His name was Timmy White, and he was only 5 years old. He was playing outside of his house in his front lawn when he suddenly disappeared. A month later, on March 1st, both Timmy and Steven walked into the Ukiah Police Department. It had been 7 years, 2 months, and 28 days since anyone had seen Steven, and they were now walking up to the police station. Timmy ran inside, then ran back out to where Steven was standing. A police officer had seen Timmy walk in and watched him run all the way out to another boy. This policeman thought that they looked and that possibly they could be in trouble, so he called another police officer who was patrolling the area to come and kind of drive by to see if they needed help so he didn't startle them by running after them. This other police officer went up to them and they then confessed that they were Steven Stayner and Timmy White. Steven was almost 15 now, and they brought him in for booking to ask him some questions about what had happened. At first, he didn't want to say anything until the police finally said that they would get whoever did this to him help if he would just give them a name. So then Steven began to give them the whole story from the beginning. So what happened in 1972? Well, a man did walk up to Steven with these religious pamphlets, like I had said, but afterwards, when he asked for the donations, and Steven said, yeah, his mom would probably like to give donations, this man asked him if he would want a ride to his house where then this man could ask his mother. He said yes, and a car pulled up, a white Buick, with another man inside. Steven got in the car, even though he was a little suspicious, and as they started driving, he realized that they were not going home to his home at all. They ended up going 22 miles away to a cabin in the woods in Kathy's Valley, and the man driving then became his main kidnapper. The search was ensuing for Steven, and all the while, he was in this cabin being raped 13 days later. Steven tried to fight back the first week, saying that he wanted to go home, and this kidnapper just continued to tell him that they did not want him anymore, that his family didn't want to take care of him any longer. Steven didn't believe that for 1 minute and said that his parents needed help with his other siblings and he needed to help them. And that is when the kidnapper said that they had done all of this, that they actually gave away their custody of Steven to him. And sadly enough, Steven kind of started to believe it. He said that how he felt in the moment was basically that it was a new kind of normal that he didn't know about before, and he was finding out now. So he just thought it was a different reality that he had never been in, and this was going to be his new one. Steven was then renamed Dennis and enrolled in Steel Lane Elementary School. And the crazy thing is, this school's district office was sent a letter from Steven's parents with flyers of Steven's picture on it to put around on the bulletins all over school in case any of the kids had seen Steven. And they threw them all away. So now this kidnapper was pretending to be Dennis's dad, and he was going to school. They even put down his real birth date, middle name, place of birth, and his last school that he attended. But they did not have any records from his previous school, and an employee actually noticed this and wrote a little note on the back of the paper saying that they needed to get records from Dennis's last school. But nobody ever did, and they didn't look into it, which means they didn't know that Dennis was Steven. So for 7 years, Steven had been attending this school, and nobody noticed that it was him. And he was far too brainwashed at this time to ask for help or even know how or even know that this isn't how he was supposed to be living. But that all changed in February of 1980 when his kidnapper brought back another boy. Steven's kidnapper had tried multiple times to get Steven to help out with the kidnapping of other children, and every time Steven sabotaged it somehow and made it not possible. Steven didn't help this time. He didn't even know this was happening. And now a little boy, 5-year-old Timmy White, was trapped with him. He began to be very protective over Timmy, knowing what he had gone through all those years. And he refused to let his kidnapper put a hand on him. He would come home at about lunchtime every day to make sure there was no way that his kidnapper had free time with Timmy. He tried to get him back home multiple occasions and sneak him out, but every time his kidnapper would either skip work or come home early, and it made it nearly impossible. Until the day they showed up at the police department. You see, this kidnapper had brainwashed Stephen so much by this point that he let him do pretty much whatever he wanted. He had multiple jobs and would often be gone, but Stephen had no idea even how to get help or how to ask for it, so he didn't. He was allowed to drink, to smoke, to do things that a 14-year-old boy should not be allowed to do, and he was also given a dog, kind of as a bargaining chip, to stay. But with Timmy, he knew he had to get him home. He felt it inside of him that he had to get this boy home. And on March 1st, when his kidnapper was out at a night security job, he took Timmy and he hitchhiked all the way from the cabin to Ukiah to the police department. But that wasn't where he originally wanted to take him. Timmy lived in Ukiah, and Stephen knew this, so he wanted to either take him to his babysitter's house or his house, but Timmy was only 5. He didn't remember where that was. So after Stephen figured that out, they happened upon a police department, thankfully, and that's when Stephen decided to send Timmy inside. Stephen was just going to leave at that point. He wasn't going to turn him in. I don't know what was going through his mind at the time, but he was just going to leave once he got Timmy to a safe place. But Timmy saved his life too, you see, because when he ran back out and the police saw both of them, that is when they knew something suspicious was happening. Then Stephen gave up the name of the man who had tortured him for 7 years, Kenneth Parnell. The search for Kenneth began, and once they brought him in, Stephen identified him face to face. After he did that though, Stephen got to begin his journey home, and Timmy was given back to his family. Stephen didn't know his middle name, his birth date, and he also misspelled his last name, Stayner. But even though his kidnapper, Kenneth, had called him Dennis for 7 years, he knew his real name was Stephen. So him and a police officer made their way back to Stephen's hometown in Merced. And Kenneth was arrested on suspicion of abduction as the sun rose the next day. They thought if Stephen's accusations weren't enough to get him in prison, then his previous offenses might be. Kenneth Parnell was 49 at the time, but he seemed to be disturbed from birth. At the age of 5, he pulled out 4 of his own teeth with pliers just because. And then he began injuring himself just on the regular. At the age of 13, he himself was sexually assaulted by an older man, and then he set fire to a pasture nearby in anger after that, and that was when he was caught and jailed for the first time and put in juvie. At 14, he stole a car and he was arrested and put in a male's facility, a male holding facility. And that is when it was noted that he started to have irregular homosexual experiences, which that wording in itself makes me angry, because why is irregular even in there? But I get that in that time, that's how it was. It's awful, but yeah, I just want to put that out there. Don't agree with it, but that is how it was stated in the notes at the time. At 16, he was arrested for public sex acts, and he also stole a car. But when he was put into jail, he escaped to chase a boy that he had a crush on. And when they found him, they put him back in jail where he tried to commit suicide. And when he didn't successfully do that, they put him in a mental facility where he broke out again to chase that same boy he had a crush on. He was, of course, arrested again, and they held him there until he was 17 years old. But when Kenneth was 19, he was arrested and convicted of sexually assaulting a 9-year-old boy. He was diagnosed as a sexual psychopath and sent to a mental institute where he escaped twice. That is when they moved him up to minimum security prison, and then they had to go to medium security prison, and then maximum. In total, in this time, he spent 3.5 years in prison, and then he was paroled if he went to get psychiatric treatment, which of course he didn't. So then he was jailed for 3 more months until he was paroled again. 4 years later, He robbed at gunpoint a service station in Salt Lake City in Utah and was convicted and got 5 to life. But 7 years later, he was paroled under the conditions that he never entered Utah again. 5 years later is when he kidnapped Stephen with the help of a man named Erwin Edward Murphy. This man he knew from a job he had. Erwin was a very simple-minded man. He kind of had some problems, and so he didn't really think straight. And so Kenneth told Erwin that this was just so he could raise a kid in a religious type deal, is what he said. And Erwin, being the not so smart guy, followed along, and he was actually the man that first walked up to Stephen. Once Stephen was in school and getting older, Kenneth forced him to invite friends over from school so Kenneth could do the horrible things that he was doing to Stephen to them as well. One of those friends he actually got to help him in the abduction of Timothy White. 8 months out of the 7 years that Stephen was with Kenneth, Kenneth actually had a girlfriend named Barbara Matias who did nothing but help Kenneth in his assaulting of Stephen. She also is speculated to have tried to kidnap another boy for Kenneth, but was unsuccessful, thankfully. But when everything went down and Kenneth was being interrogated, she said she knew nothing of Kenneth's kidnappings. So while they were building a case on Kenneth, a very strong case, Timmy was back with his family and Stephen was headed back. And while he was in the car, he asked the officer, "Is my dad still alive?" And this was because right before he got abducted, his dad fell in front of him, passed out from a slipped disc. But Stephen had thought that he had had a heart attack and since then kind of had some PTSD and a fear that his father was going to die. So this entire time he lived with this fear that his father was dead and he couldn't do anything about it and he couldn't ever see him again. Thankfully, the officer could tell him that yes, his father was still alive. While on their trip, the officer actually had to stop, pull over, get out, and get some fresh air because that's how bad Stephen smelled and how bad of an environment that Kenneth had kept him in. But once they finally got to Merced, California, where his hometown was, he had a beautiful reunion with his family. And then Timmy White's family actually gave him a check for $15,000 as a reward for returning their son. It was a very happy, peaceful reunion, one that both of the boys deserved. A year later, in 1981, Kenneth Parnell was tried and convicted of the abduction of Stephen Stayner and Timmy White, but was only given 7 years. He was not charged with the assaults on Stephen or on the friends that he had brought over. Once Kenneth started his sentence, he only ended up getting 5 years for good behavior. Erwin Murphy got 2 years, and the boy that had helped Kenneth abduct Timmy, Sean Poorman, got lesser charges. But Barbara Matias was never arrested. Stephen at one point said about Erwin Murphy that Uncle Murphy was just as much of a victim as he was in his eyes, and that he was always so nice to him when he came over. But unfortunately for Stephen, life was not all butterflies and rainbows after this. Once he got home to his family and they started getting back into a normal routine, it wasn't the same because they were still kind of treating him as a 7-year-old because that's the last time they had seen him. And also now Stephen knew his life as a teenager as being one where he could drink, he could smoke, he could do what he wanted, and his family wasn't about that, him being a 15-year-old boy. So he was going to counseling, but he never really got treatment, and that is thought to be because his dad said he didn't need it. Once Stephen went back to his regular school, he was endlessly bullied for what he had gone through, what had happened to him, and he ended up dropping out. That is when he began drinking very heavily at home and was kicked out of the family home. He did an interview and it was so heartbreaking to read about because he really spoke his mind about what was happening and about how just because he was home didn't mean that everything was better. And I'll read it to you. "I returned almost a grown man, and yet my parents saw me at first as their 7-year-old. After they stopped trying to teach me the fundamentals all over again, it got better. But why doesn't my dad hug me anymore? Everything has changed. Sometimes I blame myself. I don't know, sometimes if I should have come home. Would I have been better off if I didn't? In 1985, Stephen was 20 years old and he married Jody Edmondson, who was 17. They ended up having two children, Ashley and Stephen Jr. And this really gave Stephen a sense of peace that he hadn't had before. But he still blamed himself for the abduction, which is so, so heartbreaking. He ended up staying in his hometown through his life and worked at a Pizza Hut there while he was trying to become a security guard, and he was working at the police stations, talking to people about child abductions, talking to kids about stranger danger. But on September 17th of 1989, it was a rainy day. Stephen was now 24, and just when his life was getting to be peaceful again, truly for him on the inside, he was driving home from work on a motorcycle when he got into a wreck with a car. He had very severe injuries on scene, and once he got to the hospital, he died in the hospital. This other car fled the scene, but before Stephen's funeral, they actually came forward. The driver of the other car was given 3 months in jail and a $100 fine. Stephen's funeral was held on September 20th, and 500 people attended, one of them being the boy he saved, Timmy White, who is now 14 years old. Timmy actually had a much easier time adjusting back to life due to the small amount of time that he was abducted because of Stephen's heroic actions. Timmy had a wife, two kids, he became a deputy sheriff. So Timmy was called to testify at a trial for his kidnapper. Kenneth Parnell, as I said, was paroled, so he had been out for quite a long time, and now was being tried for human trafficking a four-year-old boy, and Timmy White was there to testify against him. Sean Poorman, the one who had helped kidnap Timmy, was also called to testify. You would think that there would be some bad blood between them, but actually during the trial, they went up to each other, they hugged, and they talked, and it seemed as though Timmy forgave him. Together, they put Kenneth Parnell in prison for good, because on January 21st of 2008, he died inside the prison. Timmy White went on to live for himself and for Stephen, and to use his past trauma the best way he could to make the world a better place. He really did amazing things in his lifetime, but unfortunately, he too had a very short-lived life for going through such horrible things as a kid. At 35 years old, he died on April 1st of 2010 of pulmonary embolism. But surprisingly enough, the Stayner family was not done being the public eye, but this time it was going to be for a completely different reason. They were going to be looked at now not as the victims, but as the criminals. Well, one of them. A year after Stephen's death, his older brother, who is 4 years older than him, Carrie, was convicted of murders. And yes, plural. In 1999, he was convicted of being the Yosemite Park serial killer. And that is just crazy to me. There is so much that goes along with that. He actually had tried to gain sympathy from people saying that his parents neglected him because of his little brother's abduction, and that he didn't get the love that he deserved, and so that is why he became a killer. There's some crazy things that intertwine into this case. You want me to make a video about the Yosemite Park killer, about Stephen's brother? I would love to do that for you. Just let me know. But the main question I want to ask you guys is, how do you think that nobody recognized Stephen Stayner while he was in school? You would think that some adult, some faculty member, or even some kid would have seen him, his poster, his picture, somewhere. They weren't that far away. I don't understand. Someone had to notice a resemblance, or even just saw the bad condition that Kenneth kept him in as far as his home life, and kind of looked into it a little more. Because if they would have looked into it, they would have seen there's no school records, and maybe if they would have done something with the records, they would have found out that a dentist Parnell did not exist. And I want to know why the police officer who saw them at the police department that day knew to follow them. Was it just because they looked suspicious, or was it because he recognized them? Because you'd think that if he recognized them, then he would have seen them somewhere out and about at school, or police would have gone to the school at some point to talk to them. Or did they just never cross paths the entire 7 years? It's just crazy to me, because it didn't seem like, from what Steven said, that Kenneth was like, you have to be home, you have to be locked up. Like, he wasn't really kept tied down or anything. Although I'm sure when you're in that situation and you're being brainwashed into thinking that you're a different person and they have this power over you and you feel like you can't escape, then you wouldn't really want to leave the house. You wouldn't really want to do anything else for fear of them, which is awful. But I can kind of understand why he didn't go anywhere else besides school, you know? But that's just... there was a whole bunch of just awful scenarios that kept playing out for Steven, that he was never recognized, that he was never found. But thankfully, even though he didn't think he could save himself, like I said, Timmy White in a way saved him, he saved Timmy, and they together got out of such a horrible situation. This story, like I said, is so sad, but it's so inspiring in a way, because we can all make it out of anything we're struggling with, and we can be better, we can have better lives, even though it's going to be hard. It's not going to be all wonderful afterwards, and I like that this story shows that, because it is true. You don't just go through horrible things and are instantly better and always better. There are always going to be struggles, but it's how you deal with them. And yeah, abduction stories just like have a place in my heart. After I did that girl in the bunker one, something about them, they just pull up my heartstrings, but they're so inspiring as far as how these little kids or even adults deal with situations like this with such strength. So make sure to thumbs up if you want more abduction videos, if you want more cases. Always let me know down below if you have any cases you want me to do or any video ideas you have for me. I will let you guys go. Bye.
You are worthy of life too, no matter how much you've suffered through. We are